Yes.
Now, you guys really want to listen to her talking about it, for
you. Of course you do.
Of course you do. It's going to be great. You can chug that.
Don't chug coffee, but leave it anyway. No, come on.
Welcome everyone in the room and online to the third edition of Codum X. Codum X is a weekly talk hosted at Codum about anything in technology or surrounding technology. If you have any questions during the talk, please write them down and leave them till the end. Also, for the people online, you can enter your questions in the chat box and we will get back to you.
Thank you, Lorena. Our speaker today is Emily Jacocometti. She has a background in communication and gender studies. And in 2008, she founded her own company, Flavor, which is a gamification company. And today, she's going to tell us a little bit about, and now I forgot, about tech, art, and everything else. Please, a round of applause for Emily Jacocometti.
Hi. I'm going to start with some expectations management because I was at the Beurs van Berlage and I ran into Dominique, I think. And she said, what are you going to talk about? And she said something really smart, I think something about React or JavaScript. And I thought, no, okay, that is not what I'm going to talk about. I don't have a technical background. I'm more like, does anybody know this show, the IT crowd? Yes, okay, I'm more like Jen trying to download the internet. So we've established two things. I don't know a lot about technology, except the application of it, and I am old. Okay, because I still watch the show on TV. I am also a co-CEO, which is a bit of a strange title. I think most people have different titles on LinkedIn. The reason I'm a co-CEO is because I have another half. I wouldn't say better half, but there he is. If there's any Dutch people, he might look familiar. Yes. Yeah, try going out to lunch with him. It's an actor, but he's specialized in storytelling. That is something that is a vital part of gamification. Together, we run four companies at this point. Flavor is the one that I am here for today, which is basically a little bit of the studio. That's where we experiment with new ideas, new formats. And then we have three companies that specialize in different products. The first one is Hackshield. And that's a game to teach children how to be safe on the internet. The second is Collegia, gamified learning environment. Basically, we try to make learning fun. And the third one is Quinn, where we train people under pressure. But I didn't really want to start there today because I watched this documentary. I'm not sure if anybody knows who this is. No. Oh, okay. This is really interesting. This is Brené Brown. She teaches vulnerability and shame. And she gave a TED talk once, and she said, I was armed with all these facts, and I was on a plane, and I thought, you know, maybe I have to adapt my story to the audience and just be vulnerable and talk about things I really want to talk about that will add value to somebody else. So I threw away my very slick presentation. So if it's a little bit grainy here and there, it's because I thought, what would be helpful to you as an audience? For starters, it's watch Brené Brown. It's really good. And second of all, I thought maybe we can sort of try and find an answer to this question together. Because my perspective is different. I don't have a technical background. I have a background in communication, in business, and like Lorraine said, everything else. So that also means I have a different perspective on how to build a business. And I thought for you as students, if you're thinking of starting your own company, if you're thinking about things that have contact with technology such as inclusive design, that might be interesting to share my experience. So I want to answer the question, how do you use inclusive game design and gaming / storytelling to build a company and change the world? I will take you back to Groningen. This is where I studied. I studied communication and gender studies. And by the time I graduated, this guy released the first iPhone, which basically meant that my study about mass communication can just be, you know, it was obsolete within a second because, everything changed. So that was a big part of my life that made me shift my perspective. These are my two co-founders from Flavor. The guy on the right is Jain van Nichtevecht. And we traveled to China together. We went backpacking for 6 weeks. My relationship was already on the rocks, so I thought, okay, why not? We'll take a trip. But what's interesting is that he is the first of his kind, a game designer specialized in transfer of knowledge through gaming. And for 6 weeks, he talked about how he was unhappy at his company. He was just selling energy drinks, basically, and manipulating behavior. So after 6 weeks, I was fed up. I said, okay, it was really funny. We were at the Peace Square, and I yelled at him. I said, okay, stop, you know, complaining. You have two options. You either accept where you are, or you change something about your situation. So when we came back, he called me the next day. He said, I quit my job. When do we start? And I thought, that's not necessarily what I was planning. I had a really nice and comfy job lined up. But I thought, you know, why not? Everything's changing. My relationship has stopped. Why not take a chance? So that's how we started. We started in a very dodgy garage in a bad part of town. The first day I came to the office, we literally had to go around police tape to get to our office. So I asked him, you know, what was your search criteria? He said, I looked for something cheap. So that's how we started. And what we did is I came into this completely new world because I came from psychology and communication. I was always surrounded by a majority of women. And the gaming industry looked nothing like that. And I learned that the first day because most games or most players at that point were male. And this is, of course, a little bit of a satirical way of saying that it was very homogenic. It was just one group. Now you have so many different things. There's gamification, applied gaming, serious gaming. But when I started, that wasn't necessarily the case. So I didn't really see any peers. It's interesting to see a bit of a mix here, but in the gaming industry, only 16% of employees is female, and only 1% holds a management position. And you can feel that. For about 10 years, I walked into meetings, and they would look like this. And that is not an exaggeration. And there's a few things that I learned the hard way. I studied gender, and I thought that our system was merit-based. I understand the theory of bias, but I'd never really experienced it. I thought, if I am really good, and if I'm prepared, and if I'm best at what I do, I will be successful. But in practice, it's a little bit different. For example, if you start a business and you're looking for an investment, as a female, you have about 1.6% chance of being funded, which means out of this room, there will be nobody. And that's daunting if you start that those are the odds. So there's a big disadvantage, especially if you're the person that is visible and diversity is limited. If you get a chance and you get started as a male, you're still 5 times more likely to get to a million than as a female founder. So I came into this industry that wasn't very diverse, and I also had a lot of other biases to conquer, but it also had an upside. It made us very visible, and it made us stand out from other companies. We had a diverse team, and we also understood from a very early point that the audience that we were working for was also diverse. It wasn't just boys ages 16 to 25. It was way bigger than that, especially with the mobile devices. Accessibility was much broader. still some fun examples of what it's like to be a girl in the game industry or a woman. I want to give you two examples because I can give you the theory, but if I give you my own experience, it might be more understandable or tangible. So we had a client of ours, he was very important, and he came, so I wanted to greet him at the door to make sure that he was welcomed, because I had a negotiation with him. So I was standing at the door, and I stuck up my hand, and he looked me up and down, and he threw his jacket over my hand, and he said, "I'll take my coffee black." And I thought, okay. So what I did is I saw an opportunity. So I put away his jacket. I escorted him to the meeting room, got him coffee, set him down, made sure he was fine. And then I went back to my desk. I got the contracts, and I went back into the meeting room. By the time he realized that I was the person he had to negotiate with, he was so ashamed, basically, that I got everything that I wanted. So that was interesting. And then there is a second example that didn't necessarily feel as funny as this one, but there's an interesting balance of how we perceive women in the game industry, how we perceive their level of skill, their use of language, they're judged on other things. And we felt that when we had a pitch, we had prepared for weeks. And as a team, we decided that I would do the pitch. And we got a call back saying that they didn't choose us. And we were gutted because we thought that it was a great idea. A few weeks later, we got a call from the same company. And they had chosen somebody else, but it hadn't worked out. Actually, it was a big disaster. And they asked us if we wanted to revisit the pitch, if we wanted to do it again. And we said, okay, but this time we send in one of the boys, one of the founders. We changed nothing about the presentation. We kept everything the same. And the feedback was different. We got the project, we did it. But the interesting part was the first time we got feedback that said, it's not ambitious enough, it's too soft, it's not what we're looking for. The second time they said, this is innovative, it's daring, it's experimental. So it's interesting to think about diversity and perception. Okay, so why is this even a problem, except for my daily life? Who has seen this? Let's talk about a little bit of design and inclusion. This is a new HIV drug. It helped prevent HIV. And it just hit the market. It's been FDA approved for men only, because the medicinal system only has male-focused testing groups. I just want to give you a few examples to see why inclusion is important if you talk about the design process. If you have a wheelchair and a group that thought of this ramp, you're in trouble. There's a lot of examples about algorithms not recognizing dark skin. So if you're in an office and you move, you're still working in the dark. This is about inclusion. Not everybody has accessibility, and the design process is not very well thought through. This one's a bit grainy, but interesting for you, is that I have girls, ages 6 and 4. They are both very interested in programming and STEM, but I already know statistically the odds that they will do what you're doing, follow this education, are very slim. Somewhere in the process, they do get eliminated or not. Oh, and if you have a heart attack as a female, you're screwed because the handbook, thank you. The manual only describes male symptoms for a heart attack. So if you go into the ER saying I'm either nauseous, they will probably say that it has to do with female symptoms, but they don't recognize the fact that you're having a heart attack. So the mortality rate for women is about 20 times as high based on the fact that they don't recognize the symptoms. Okay, so I want to talk a little bit about inclusion and diversity in the design process. But I want to also do it that makes sense. So I want to use gamification. We came up with a design method. It took us 10 years to get to this point, and I thought maybe it's good to break it down piece by piece. Let's start with the storytelling part. Okay, so if you go back to this question, we talked a little bit about inclusive design and why that's important. But now I want to show you how that works when you add gaming and storytelling into the mix. Okay, so imagine you're a woman that goes into the jungle. You run into this guy, and he's really angry, and he tries to attack you. So what do? You run away. Very good. As game designers, we look at hormonal systems. We look at behavior that is ingrained in us. So for example, if you go into the jungle and you walk into a big gorilla that's trying to kill you, your flight or fight mechanism will urge you to run away, flight. What also happens is that your body will produce adrenaline. It will make you feel invincible. Adrenaline is the drug where it takes away any boundary. If you get stuck between a rock with your arm, it gives you the ability to, you know, saw it off or rip off your own arm just to get free. That lasts about 20 minutes. Then you hit the next hormone, it's dopamine. Dopamine will force you to slow down. If you're running from the jungle, it will tell your body you're not invincible. This state cannot last, you need to calm down. This is a very interesting drug because it has a lot of applications. The most famous one, of course, is the happy drug, where if you get a like on Instagram, it will create a little bit of dopamine. Then you have cortisol, and that is the drug where if you stop for a moment and calm down, you'll start shaking. And what that does is it forces you to slow down, but it will also ensure that you have a memory of that moment, that you will remember what happened. And there's a reason for that, because you have to tell others. But I'm going to get to that. So this is something as game designers and storytellers that we work with. It's a lot of theory, so I thought of maybe giving you a small example. Let's say you have a checklist that has 20 tasks on them. If you tick one task, your body will produce dopamine. It will give you a quick fix, essentially. It's the same for Facebook, one like, one comment. It will give you a small feeling of happiness, but it's very short. If you go to oxytocin, are there any mothers in the room? No? Okay, this is a fun drug if you're a mother. It will, I see one dad in the back, oh yes. It will induce labor. It will give you contractions, but it will also make you feel love for your child. It's what we call the love drug. If you go running, if you make love, it doesn't really matter. This is the hormone that you produce. It will make you feel connected to somebody else. And then you have serotonin. If you take your list of tasks, let's say that you clear all of them. Your entire list is clean. That doesn't really happen often, at least not in my case. So if that happens, I feel very relaxed. I'm thinking, oh, I'm done. So for example, if my husband calls me, I will tell him, I will say, I got through my entire list. And that is the serotonin talking. It's a feeling of accomplishment. And it will last longer. So what we're trying to look at is how can we manipulate these hormonal systems to modify your behavior? And that's what we do as a game designer. It's still quite experimental. And we have a reason that we do that in storytelling. The woman that went into the jungle, she experienced adrenaline, she experienced all these drugs in that cycle. And there's a reason for that, because as a species, we depend on storytelling. If she has three sons and she's able to convey, and she's a good storyteller, she will tell about the gorilla in the jungle, and they are good listeners, then they can all agree not to go to the exact same spot at the same time and survive. If she's not a good storyteller, then she can't convey it, and two of her sons might die. Okay, if there's anything you take from this presentation, I would suggest that it's this. If you want, you can take a picture, but this is interesting. This is the way that we structure stories. There's a certain set of rules that applies to everything. The movies you watch, the books you read, they all follow the same line. Let me give you an example. Lord of the Rings. So you have a character. In the beginning, the character is always introduced. In this case, that's Frodo from the Shire. There's a situation. Evil is coming your way. That's a problem because the Shire will cease to exist. And we have a vague notion of a solution, If we throw the ring into my Mount Doom, that might work. And then you go, bless you. And then you go into the next step of the structure. That is, you know, you assemble your fellowship. You go through this journey. You have to overcome obstacles. And in the end, there's always a battle. You always have to win. Even if you die, there is a learning from that. That is the structure that we follow. As humans, if you don't follow this structure, we don't absorb the information. For example, if you have a flat tire and you're standing at the coffee machine and you're telling your fellow students, you know what, I had a flat tire, then the question will be, okay, what happened? If your answer is, oh, well, nothing, I just got picked up and everything got fixed, it's not a good story. It's not something that we find interesting because it doesn't follow the set structure of rules. If you look a little bit more closely, this is something that you see everywhere. If you know, you'll recognize it. Politicians, they do the same thing. For example, Trump, he introduces characters. We have gang members, rapists, murderers. The situation is that America, you know, is in a decline. The problem is that it's getting worse. We have a vague notion of a solution. Build a wall. That is what populist politicians do. They use the first part of telling a story. What's interesting is that the opposite side uses the second part. So Democrats will have objections. They will say, but it's difficult. There's obstacles. We can't build a wall. It's too expensive. It's all in the second part of the structure. And it's not interesting to a broader audience that just wants to start with this way of storytelling. Okay, so this is how we tell stories, but this is the linear path. This is a linear situation. I get to decide the rules. I get to convey the information in a structure that I choose. But in the real world, it doesn't happen like that. So I brought a little video. It's a case of an experiment that we did. For the people who didn't recognize my co-CEO, you will recognize him after this movie, because he also played a part on it. It's a case called Freshers, or Feuten in the Netherlands. And it's an experiment for us in how we can use storytelling. See if that works.
Silentium!
Welkom. Stelletje kutfeuten. Bij de grote finale. De climax. Uw apotheose.
Freshers is a Dutch television series about the members of the notorious fraternity, HSC Mercurius. During the second season, we started a transmedia pilot where fans could join the fraternity. We found out that this is what people want. They want to be part of the story world. This year, Freshers didn't only air the third season, but also released a feature film. BNN, Elastique, and Spectre decided to kick off a real transmedia campaign with multiple layers of interaction. 1. Watch. Downloading the mobile app allowed you to watch next week's episode and other exclusive video content. 2. Play.
Welkom. Dit is Mercurius,
de meest moderne vereniging van Nederland.
To join the fraternity, you had to go through a hazing process. The user was put to the test with in-app games and quizzes. As a member, you had to earn all kinds of achievements to improve your status within the fraternity. Three, connect. Players became ambassadors. Sharing content, inviting friends for their subsection, and working together also improved their status. People were activated to enter social media contests to become a committee member and could even win a ticket to the film premiere. 4. Participate. When exploring the app, you could stumble upon new and exclusive storylines.
Hallo, ik ben René de Wit. De Senaat die heeft gevraagd of ik een blog wil bijhouden. En dat ga ik doen in de vorm van video's.
The series supporting characters got the lead in our app. Their stories enhanced the story world and encouraged you to personally interact with the characters by email and social media. One story led to an ARG about Filius Septimus, a secret society that rules the fraternity. 5. Experience. There were possibilities to meet the characters face-to-face at live events, such as the ARG's live finale.
So I wasn't really sure if I should show you this, because A, it's very old, B, it's something we don't do anymore, because we have pivoted towards trying to solve complex societal problems. But the reason I found this old movie again is because it was experimental. And it was an experiment in using storytelling, but also in creating a world where the end user made the decisions. And it went that far that in the end, the community became bigger than the audience watching on TV. And they all went through the hazing process voluntarily. And that for us as game designers was really interesting to see that if you lock certain content, if you engage an audience, that they are willing to go through half an hour of a digital hazing process just by experimenting. And what we did is we created a world, and that is where we're going to go back on track, by using storytelling and gamification. And I think that most people, when I tell them that I'm in gaming, they think of this part of the industry. It's where storytelling and gamification are combined, and that's where you get Horizon Zero Dawn, World of Warcraft, Fortnite. That is not where we are. Clearly, budget-wise, there's a big difference. I think Fortnite was about $1.5 billion. But also the intent behind it, it has an entertainment point of view. We want to entertain and maybe monetize. What we do is we learn from those games and we apply them to solve problems. This is the lady going into the jungle, narrative-based learning. And this is game-based learning, which people think is new, but basically is really old. If you think of a lion and a cub playing, then the lion will let the cub play and experiment until a certain point, and it will just give it a little tap. But it won't use nails. So it's a playful environment where there's a set of rules, but there's also autonomous freedom to experiment. In the middle, there was a big question mark. And it took us 10 years, but we came up with a term for it. We call it hero-centered design. This is where I want to go back to the inclusive design method, because what we learned is that it takes two things. If we want to have an impact on society, because we want to change the world, remember, then we need to understand that we as a company have to have a diverse group, but the end user is the one in control. So what we try to do is facilitate that they become a hero and that they change something in the real world. Okay, that's enough theory. I thought maybe I'll give you an example. We were at an event with a lot of kids, and this was for Hackshield. And we asked a simple question. We said, okay, which child in this room, ages 9 to 12, know more about computers, internet, and phones than their parents? And every finger of every child in the room just shot up. And they said, yes, we know more than their parents. In the back, the parents were going, yes, that's true. They know more than us. And it's interesting because if we look at the things that we're trying to tackle, this, for example, has to do with cybersecurity. We can choose the route where we try to create awareness within companies. That is fine, but we chose a different route. We said, what if we use our hero-centered design method to create an academy for children, ages 9 to 12, and they go through this game that you can see in the background, and we teach them adversarial thinking. So it looks a little bit like chess, and what we try to do is make them understand how they can think three steps ahead of their adversary. Because that's what you do for cybersecurity. We launched this, and it was really interesting because the first children, the first 100,000 kids have gone through the process, and we are now creating cyber agents, so they get a badge. And the interesting part is that the police and the Justice Department actually acknowledge these children, and that's the first step. So we've basically created heroes, or we hope we did. And the second step is for the heroes to start assembling their team. So what we did is we said, okay, you're now a cyber agent. But now we have to create a ripple effect. So you can assemble your team. Maybe you can invite your grandfather. You can invite your mother, your brother, your neighbor. It doesn't really matter. And they all get a place in your team. And you're only as strong as your weakest player. So if you don't teach maybe a certain topic to your grandfather, let's say fishing, and then he will have weak abilities on fishing. So if your opponent attacks your grandfather on that subject, you will get, well, basically massacred, which is an incentive for children to make sure that their team is informed. So what we did is we said, let's try and reach a different group, create heroes, and then let them decide how to create real change. Okay, is everybody interested in a second example, or shall I just skip through? Okay, this is a little bit more personal. So my mother had a heart attack a couple of months back, and the ambulance was there within about 3 minutes, which is really fast. And what I didn't know, but what I've learned since then, is that that is not the case for every location in the Netherlands. We try, actually the ambulance should be there within 15 minutes, but we can't guarantee that. It's because there's a lack of personnel. So what we did is we partnered up with ambulance dispatchers. So if you call 112, you'll get an ambulance dispatchers. And they're grossly overworked. And there's only so much that the system can optimize. But we decided to train them in making sure ambulances reach patients on time. And what we did is we started really simple. We copied their working environment. That's why it looks like this, which is not very nice. We copied their working environment, but we put a layer over it, which is the gaming layer. And we start by saying, just take a seat behind the computer, and we're going to start you off very easy. There's one person that's going to break a leg somewhere in rural, the Netherlands. And that's about it. But level 50, we drop a bomb on the station. Or we have an alien invasion, or the Germans are coming back. It doesn't really matter. But what we do is we use gaming mechanics to prepare them for real-life situations. And I thought that this was a really good example, because the effect of that is that they become better at their job, making sure there are more ambulances that arrive on time, making sure more lives are saved. I think that's pretty awesome. If you can use gaming, which is really fun and simple, and they actually enjoy playing a game, but in the end you end up saving more lives, that's pretty cool. Okay, let's talk about the last aspect, because we talked a little bit about inclusive design and about gaming, but we haven't really talked about how to build a company. And that's also because when we started, we were 24, and we had no idea what we were doing. This is the first, division of tasks, let's call it that. We were in a bar, and I had two co-founders. One was technical, and one was artistic and a game designer. So the technical guy said, I'll be responsible, I'll be the CTO, I'll do everything tech-related. The art guy said, I'll do everything design-related. And I literally got assigned everything they didn't want to do, because that's basically the term that we use for business. It's a variety of things. And in the media, our story was really good. We built this company from the garage in the Dutch part of Amsterdam up to about 100 people. And we had amazing clients. We won all these prizes. But it was not really the reality. Besides the fact that it's not a straight line from 0 to 100, we got a few things really wrong. And I thought it might be interesting to share those things with you, because that might be valuable if you're thinking of starting your own company. So somewhere halfway, we fell on our face because we didn't have any financial stability. This is kind of a broad term, but what happened is we worked for clients. And if you work for clients, if there's work, there's money. If there's no clients, there's no money. But if you are growing and you have a team that is basically 100 people, the moments that you don't have work and you don't have money, you will go through your cash. And that is something we understood too late. At some point, there was a lull in the work that we were doing, and we hadn't prepared for that. So we went through our backup reserves, and we came to a point where we couldn't pay everybody. So what do you do? And the biggest realization is that we had only planned on being a company that provides services. You want something done, we'll do it as long as you pay, and the machine keeps rolling. And what we hadn't realized is that we weren't building a steady income stream. Right now, there's all these terms. We're a SaaS, software as a service. What's interesting about these business models is that they provide you with recurring revenue. And that's something we didn't have. We went up and down. And at some point, if the down's below the zero line, you go bust. So what we did is we scaled back. And we said, we're going to do it right this time. So we went back to a much smaller team. But we built it up with a steady cash flow. The second mistake we made is that, well, we thought that we had to follow a path that was already there. We weren't experimenting. We were looking at what people were already doing. We weren't innovating. We were just thinking, how did they do it? How can we copy that? Not necessarily plagiarize, but do the same thing everybody else is already doing. We weren't experimenting at all, which means that we weren't innovating and we weren't creating real value. I understand that those are a lot of container terms, but let me show you how we fixed it. For example, HackShield, we thought of that in what we called a playground. So we had 15 students from different disciplines. We had people in psychology, we had people who taught children at high school, and we said, here is a societal issue. This is a complex problem. Can you look at it from different perspectives and come up with a solution? This is what they come up with. And we didn't have a business model at all. We weren't making any money. So what we did is we invested our own money, which is a nice way of saying that you go without pay for 6 months and you live with your parents on bread and peanut butter. But in the end, what it did is it gave us time to experiment and see what works. Because if you create a new business model, then there is room for growth. And when we did it the first time around, we weren't scalable. We had 100 people, but if we had more work, we had more people. So it was just a straight line. And by experimenting with business models, we created something that's more of a curve. So if we get this right, we can either go times 10, times 100, but we can scale the technology. Yeah, and the third one is that we didn't have a good culture. And what's interesting is that I recognized that there wasn't enough diversity in our own team, but never really did anything about it until the products or the projects that we were doing weren't successful with our audience. And it took us a long time to understand that the group that we have didn't reflect the people that we were designing for. The culture was also, I wouldn't say toxic, but it wasn't balanced. And we implemented a lot of changes. The biggest one is that we created a culture where the number one priority is that you get to be you, whatever that is. What that also did is that it attracted a whole bunch of people that were motivated by completely different things. Their incentive was to improve the world, look at design processes, and the company culture eventually changed the entire company into something better. Okay, so if you look at this question, I hope we talked a little bit about inclusivity in design, using storytelling and gamification, and to build a company hopefully sustainable enough that we can create a real impact and change the world, because that is what we do. We try to create heroes that change the world. Okay. Are you doing good on time? Okay, perfect. Are there any questions? Yes.
Thank you very much. I believe we'll give you a pitch box on the next question.
I'm first. That's a rookie mistake. Thank you.
Hi, Emily. Thank you for your presentation. I'm very interested about the inclusive design and all the like gender biases you mentioned. Mm-hmm. So can you elaborate on, like, in your process, like when doing the projects, like what areas have you changed to make sure that the solutions are inclusive? And can you maybe also give a few examples of that? Thank you.
Yeah. So the first thing we did is we acknowledged that we had an inclusivity problem, that we weren't diverse enough, and we changed different areas. The first thing was our own team. So we actually had a stockholder meeting, and we put it on the agenda. And the first step was awareness, which is a nice way of saying that we didn't know we had a problem until we found out that it was actually affecting our bottom line. So the first thing we did was we changed our own teams. We have what you call a critical mass threshold. There's an interesting book that you can read. It's called We Already Have a Woman. You have to look at the Dutch term. I thought it was a really good title. And what it says is that if you want to create diversity in a design process, you have to reach critical mass. You already have a woman is not enough. If you look at gender diversity, then you need 30% to have sustainable diversity that will affect the products that you make, that will affect the bottom line, that will affect the culture. So that was the first thing that we did. We said, okay, we're going to have this level, 30%, and that is a huge impact because you have to talk to recruiters, to HR. Everyone has to be aware of the fact that that is what we're looking for. We're not trying to exclude everybody or anybody based on merit, but we are trying to look at building a diverse team. And then on the other end, we looked at the products we were making, and that's actually really interesting because our testing groups were also not very diverse. So now, when we test anything, there's a checklist. You know, do we have a representation of the group we're designing for? And if they give input, then that is valuable feedback. So we don't take small groups anymore. We try to make them diverse based on a certain set of variables. So across the board, a lot of changes and a lot of impact as well. Yeah.
So I've noticed that you have a very, very Western heroic narrative that consists... I noticed that you seem to have a very Western heroic narrative, which is very problem, solution, next problem, next solution, until you win, kind of thing. But I was wondering, because I also didn't see much storytelling in your games. It seemed like you gave an example that you you take family members and you can put them in your game. But have you thought of implementing archetypes such as, let me restart. There's a more Eastern version of storytelling that doesn't go problem solution until you win. It goes, you're building a group and there are different roles in a group, such as the leader, you have a lancer, you have a heart, all kinds of roles. And I don't really see that reflected into your design. I was wondering if that was a conscious decision that you left it out, or if it was too hard, or if you haven't thought about it yet.
Okay, so let me see if I understand the question right. You're saying that we are following a bit of a Western design or a Western set of rules for a design process that leads to maybe not a diverse group of archetypes or personas. Is that your question?
Not necessarily that they're not diverse, I just don't see a focus on archetypes and that kind of storytelling.
That's a good question. I think I may not be the right person to answer it, but I will try.
Thanks.
If I look at my own experience and the design process that we implement, you are correct. We follow a very strict design process. We use an agile method. So as to your problem solution, that might be right. What we do is we think that we have a solution, we test it, and then we adapt based on the feedback, and hopefully that will lead to an optimized outcome. And as for architects or archetypes, I don't really know the answer to that, because what we work with is personas, And we try to create different sets of personas that represent a broader audience. So for example, in the Hex Shield game, we're very conscious that we have a character creator where you can be young, old, male, female, any color you like, so that people at least recognize themselves and create their own character. And within the storyline of the game, we have some characters that you might be able to relate to, such as, in this case, it's two young kids. The girl gets hacked, and the boy tries to help her and actually makes things worse. And that's also the call to action. They ask the community, oh my god, I screwed up. Maybe you guys can help us. And in the process, you meet all these characters in the storyline. You are correct that it's not really in the presentation because that might be going in depth a bit too much. But if you really want to know more about this, I would have to ask the person responsible for implementing storytelling and the didactic framework that supports the storytelling in the project. And I'm not that person.
Okay. Thanks. So, Opa, so you were responsible for everything else, not the design and not the tech. So, yes. Question about that. How much of the initial process for setting up a company is cold calls and just cold emails and just talking to people you don't know? Or was it more the network that you get new people and partners and so on?
No, we didn't have a network when we started. It was 100% cold calls. When we started, literally the first day I came into the office, we had a nice logo up on the wall and we had our desks with laptops. And we sat down and we realized, oh my god, we don't have any clients. We don't have any work. Plus, we don't have any money coming in. How do we deal with that? And the first thing we did, because we didn't have any existing network, we were fresh out of school, we didn't know anybody, it's just call, call, call. We thought of who might benefit from the things that we could make. And we just started calling. And at some point, we had a lucky break. We called an advertisement company. And they were experimenting a little bit with gaming. And what we did is we made a deal with them. So we worked for basically nothing. But in exchange, we were allowed to not only mention them, but also the end client in our portfolio. And that was a big name. And that got the ball rolling, especially when we implemented the product. It was something really simple. It was a bank, and they wanted to teach their employees certain things about products. And they had a PDF of 99 pages, and it didn't work. So we made a really simple game for them that allowed cheating. And they could use the PDF to sort of cheat their way through. And everybody thought that was really funny. And everybody individually thought that they were really smart by cheating. But in the end, they knew more about the product than before they played the game. So it was really successful. And that led to another client from the same advertisement agency. And they said, we want the same as them. And that sort of got the ball rolling. But this was in 2008. So we had two banks as the client. And then the crisis hit. So we saw our entire portfolio go poof. And then we had to do it all over again. And we didn't have... So we rebuilt the company about 3 times, and every time it's just going out there, telling your story, hoping that people see something in you. And what gave us our biggest break in the crisis is the fact that companies that we worked for, they had set budgets, and they saw those budgets just being halved because of the crisis, but they still all had managers that wanted the same results. So they were forced to look at other solutions, and that was an opportunity for us. So we called companies and we said, you know, we know that you need to do your same educational, but your budget's probably less. Do you want to have a try? And we think that we can accomplish the same effect for a lot less money. But it was a lot of calling.
Oh, okay, then follow-up question, which you already hinted.
Yeah.
So how much... what part played the storytelling in this cold calling and getting people on board?
Oh, zero. We didn't know what we were doing at that point. We had just started. It takes a long time to figure out how things work because we had the theory and we had a lot of goodwill because people thought that we were young and that we were driven and enthusiastic. But only after doing it several times that we look back and think, okay, that's how it works, and now we can explain why that's how it works. So in the beginning, we didn't know what we were doing at all. It's taken 10 years to scratch the surface and get to a point where you think, okay, so this is something that's repetitive, and you start to recognize the patterns. And that's when the whole storytelling came into play.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Are you looking for any interns? And if so, what are the qualifications?
Yes, actually, I already saw, oh, what's his name? Jorn, I think. Yeah, is Jorn in the audience? Nope, too bad. No, I know Martijn. Martijn had an internship at Flavor, I think, or at Quinn, yeah. The answer to your question is yes, we're looking for interns. We have, I think, about 4 openings spread over different companies. And if you want to know what it's like, you can ask Martijn if he enjoyed his internship and what we are as a team and how it is to work at one of the companies. But yes, please apply, because we have enough room, and we're very serious about not using interns as free labor, but making sure that there's actually a trajectory that you follow where you learn something that is your goal. And we're sort of working a lot on improving that. So yes, please apply. Any other questions?
Anyone else? No? All right. Oh, well, actually, one more.
It's more about interns in general. So, okay. Because I came from the society where we don't have that many internships involved mm-hmm. for students. But here I see that every student, they first do internship. They discover the world of working for the company, and then they keep learning, and then they got finally employed and have a contract. So the question is, what is there for the company? Why, for example, your company mm-hmm. hire interns, and why are you interested in interns?
Several reasons. The reason we hire is that, that's a good question. One is a fresh perspective. Somebody that's probably a lot younger than us and or has not as much preconceived notions on how things should work or how they're already working. So that's a fresh perspective. And then it's really good if you convey knowledge. So it's also good for the people working at the company to make sure that they guide people that are younger, to make sure that they're also up to date on their knowledge. It's a big hiring pool for us. So if the intern is really good, I think about 60% of the people that we hired may have started off as a junior or as an intern. So it's also a good way to see if there's a match. Oh my God, there's so many upsides for a company to work with interns. I think that would be the answer there. Let me think what else is important. Yeah, it's mostly the perspective and to see if there's a professional match.
All right, great. Any more questions? Yeah?
Thank you for your presentation, for sharing everything. I hope your mom is okay.
Yes.
I like the exam because it was personal, so you wanted to solve a problem because it was close to you.
Yeah.
Do you have any other ambitions that you can work on, like big plans for your company?
Well, it's actually interesting because when we were really big, we were also really unhappy. The original founder or co-founder got a burnout, and I had just had a baby, so it was very all by myself, and we were not doing too well financially, and we were really unhappy. There was a point to this. Okay, so what we did, I remember, so we changed everything. And the reason we did that is that before, we would just be driven by whatever was, it came onto our path or was asked of us. And it was always because a client thought that that was a good idea to do. And at some point, after working for clients for 10 years, we realized that that's not necessarily what made us happy. So we made a major change, and we said goodbye to all our clients except for one. And we said, we're only going to do the things that we actually believe in. So the companies that you see here are things that we invested in ourselves. Over the 10 years, we saved up a little bit of money, a small pot of gold, and we gave ourselves a year. We said, okay, we have enough to have a small or smaller team going and invest in making these products. We have a year of runway to find a business model that will actually make sure that we also have some cash coming in. And I think that's about 18 months ago. Honestly, we can see sort of light at the end of the tunnel, but it's always a little bit like Bambi on ice. And what's interesting about that is that in the first part of the journey, we were completely driven by incentives such as money or staying in existence or basically keeping a team going. And to the outside world, the story was always good. It was young entrepreneurs start in a garage, build up this multi-million dollar company, and it was a good story, but none of us were really happy. So when we decided to change that, it was a very big risk, but I'm glad we took it anyways, because if I go to, let's say, an occasion like this, and somebody doesn't know who I am and asks me, what do you do? I have more fun telling what I do now than the whole story before. That's why I was also doubtful to show you the Voet case, because it's from before. And it's interesting because of some of the mechanics that we still use, but it doesn't match with the feeling of what we do now. And now we're always aimed towards, does it make a difference? Will it solve a problem? And HackShield actually also came about because all the founders had children in the meantime. And digital literacy is not on the curriculum, at least not until 2025. And I asked my daughter's teacher, I said, do you guys teach her anything about how to be safe on the internet? And she literally needs help turning on the computer. So, no. So that's one where we started thinking, what have we learned over the last couple of years and what can we apply here that will help our children, but eventually will help a bigger group? And that's how all the companies start now. We see a problem in our own lives or in our environment, and we think, is this a bigger societal issue? And if yes, can we come up with an experiment in the flavor studio? And it starts as something small, and then if it works and if we get traction, we try to build it into a company that will be sustainable. Plus, before, we only got to work on things until the work stopped. If you work for clients, there's going to be an end to a budget or a timeline, or it doesn't matter, it's going to stop, which means the impact stops there. And if you build products, you're constantly developing and growing and working on it, so it stays relevant and the impact is potentially much greater over a longer period of time, which I'm more excited about than creating impact for money.
We have one more question from online, from David.
Yeah.
The question.
Yeah.
Many students dream to start their own company, and it can be really scary to take the leap. What was the tipping point that made you switch from wanting to do it to actually doing it?
Oh, I get this question so often. It's really funny. People always ask me, how do I start? Which is not necessarily the case for you, but a lot of people say, I already have a job and I'm already making money. I don't want to give that up, but I have a great idea or I want to start for myself. And there seems to be sort of a mental threshold as to actually getting started, when getting started can be really small. The fact that you announce it maybe on social media, or if you have one client and you try it out, it can coexist next to your day job or next to your study, and that's already getting started. I think getting started is not hard. It's making it to that point where there's enough income that it can be your only job. That's hard. And that takes time. But that's also just making mistakes and then keep going, trying again. So how do you get started? I would say done is better than perfect. So just start.
Thank you. And thank you for giving the talk today. Yeah. Big round of applause. You can find more information about the next talk on codum.nl/codumx.
Yes. Please don't put this on YouTube, but if you want to have an internship, this is my personal number.
We'll make sure we'll redact that from the final stream. If there's more questions, because we might not have gotten to everybody, Emily will stick around for a little bit, so don't hesitate to go up to her and ask your question. Okay. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you.